From KSMQ Television in Austin, this is On Cue, connecting interesting issues and interesting people. On Cue.
The Austin Human Rights Commission works in the Austin community to ensure all folks, all residents, are respected. And here to tell us more is Chair Richard Lemons. Welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here.
There is a kind of a lack of information sometimes with this organization. Doesn't get the big headlines a lot of times in the local media, but yet, especially in our part of the state these days, this is a very, very important issue and organization. Tell us a little bit about it.
I'd be happy to, Eric. First of all, I agree with you that a lot of people don't know about us. We believe as a commission that if we walk down Main Street and ask 20 people at random what they knew about the Human Rights Commission, the predominant answer would probably be duh, not knowing what we are, even if we exist. So we've been really busy getting the message out about who we are and what we're trying to do. We think that's an incredibly important part of what we're doing right now as a commission, is to make sure others know that we're out there.
Because I think of my confusion is with like civil rights commissions. You sometimes, in metropolitan areas, there are organizations that interact with police, you know, when there's a allegation of wrongdoing,
right,
that is motivated by the culture where somebody came from. So there's the name of it too can mean several different things.
Sure, it can. And we subscribe actually as the Austin Human Rights Commission to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights as subscribed by the United Nations. And it's 30 articles that talk about various things, and they do cover some of the same items of civil rights. So some of the civil rights are included in there, but it's a little more extensive list than that. Also, if people had a concern that they believed merited investigation, we do have a telephone number they can call into. It's actually Trish Weichman's number at the City Hall, and she's our city interface for the Human Rights Commission. And if there is something that needs to be investigated, we can refer people on to the state office. That's the Minnesota Department of Human Rights, which actually does the investigations.
Okay, now I'm going to throw you a real softball here. a lot of folks might think, well, human rights, that's a problem that happens someplace else. Mm. That's something I see on the news about some other continent or something where there's terrible upheaval. That's not the case. There are issues here as well.
They go on right here in our own community. There are issues with both how the citizens and how the authorities deal with individuals that are concerning. Much of that is really related to how people perceive how they're being treated. Sometimes the treatment could in fact be equal, but because of perceptions, it could feel very different. So it's really incredibly important that we understand the different paradigms around the world and how people would perceive the treatment that they receive. I've heard the term recently, equity over equality, meaning that we need to treat people in a way that fits with what is consistent with their experiences.
That's interesting. So the same action can be perceived differently.
Yeah, absolutely, it could be. Yeah, it could create some sense of discrimination where there might not have been that intent.
And what is your process within your organization? You're having community conversations.
Correct.
But break it down a little bit as to how you go about fulfilling your mission.
I'd be really happy to do that, Eric. We, first of all, the Human Rights Commission last fall asked ourselves the question, how do we live into that mission statement of creating that just and inclusive community where diversity is valued and human rights are respected? So really important for us to think about what actions should we be taking. We came back with what we started to call the eights. We educate, we communicate, we facilitate, and we advocate. And so the eights kind of became our watchword for what we're doing. And we said, within that, we really need to be thinking specifically what kind of actions we should take. So we took our mission statement and we kind of tore it apart and took out the three pieces of valuing diversity, of respecting human rights, and of creating a just and inclusive community, and considered those to be our high-level strategies. And then underneath them, we've started hanging specific action items. In our planning session, we ask each of three groups to go away and come back with the top three items that they would say would be action items to hang below those strategies. And in all three groups, they came back with conversations. So it was an independent activity that the three groups came back with, but a commonality in that one item. That's led us to believe that should be a critically important part of what we do in this year. We've been blessed. We had this concept develop right about the same time that the Episcopal Church in Minnesota offered grants to its various faith communities. And we applied for and got a grant from the Episcopal Church in Minnesota to help us with the cost of this. We will be using the resources of both the budget that we have and the grant that we received from the Episcopal Church in Minnesota.
And this will be going around and having conversations?
The basic concept would be to gather a largest possible group of people from the most diverse backgrounds that we can into a room and talk about some topics that would be of general interest. That might be things like housing and education and things that I think a lot of people are concerned about, but also potentially about what we're calling hot topics. A hot topic would be a kind of a flash event, something that comes up either nationally or locally. I think a good example of that would have been when the Adrian Peterson disciplining issue came up, that we would have had an opportunity when that happened to consider that a hot topic and to convene a conversation around that. I think specifically we would find there are a lot of cultural differences in how people discipline children in various ethnic and cultural groupings in our community, and we would see that there would be a lot of difference of opinion about how that should be done.
And then that would be the end of the conversation, or is there a one way is right and one way is not right? You know, where do we go
from there? Great question, Eric. There's several things we hope come out of a conversation. At the top level, we hope people learn something about each other. So there's just a basic learning process that we would anticipate would happen. We would hope that they come away with some empathy for each other, so they would actually be able to understand and recognize where the other person is coming from in that. In the end, though, if our conversations don't lead to some action, then we're going to regard the conversation as not as successful as we would have wanted. So we do want some sort of action to come out of it. So we don't want to prescribe that in advance. We don't know what that would be. That would be something that would hopefully develop during the course of the conversation and maybe in follow-on sessions. Some conversations might spur a second one if there's information there that still needs to be digested.
We're talking with Richard Lemons, who's the chair of the Austin Human Rights Commission. And Richard, is there a way for folks to get more information or become more part of this process?
Absolutely. Our primary point of contact is Trish Weichman. She's the Human Resources Manager for the city, and she is our liaison onto the committee. If a person is interested in joining the commission, there's an online application process that they can follow through the city website. And of course, they could get in touch with me as well. I'd be happy to talk to anybody about this.
And the waterfall. You have a picture of a waterfall, and it's a quite fitting image. Talk a little bit about it.
Yeah, it's a story we're telling right now, Eric, and we think it's really important for what we're trying to do. The idea of the waterfall is that there's this small village that sits at the base of this very beautiful waterfall, and it forms a little lake right there. And one day the villagers notice that there are babies in the lake. And of course, that causes people to react immediately, and they jump in the lake to save the babies. And then, oddly, babies continue to show up into the lake, and they continue to try to save them. And they form committees to save the babies, and they build buildings to rehabilitate the babies who have been in the water. And they're doing all this stuff. And sometime down the line, they figure out, we need to go figure out why babies are getting in the waterfall, in the river up above. So we need to send somebody upstream to figure out what that is. And a big part of what we're subscribing to now as a Human Rights Commission is we can't not save the babies if they're in the lake. If people are hungry, if they're not housed properly, if they're being treated ill, that needs to be dealt with. But there's a root cause behind that. There's something happening upstream. And a big part of what we're going to try to do with our conversations is lead the conversation toward what are the upstream causes that produce this effect that we are needing to deal with, but what could we do systemically and sustainably to prevent that from happening going forward?
Very insightful. That helps the visual part. That really helps tell the story.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard, for joining us.
Oh, thank you.
And good luck on your conversations.
Great.